safety, quality, environment, ISM code elements, SEC.III. Structure of the ISM code. Part A, implementation. Preamble. General. Elements. Part B, certification and verification. Certification and periodical verification. Interim certification. Verification. Forms of certificates. Preamble. 1. Purpose. 2. A.443.11. 3. A.680.17. 4. Based on general principles and objectives. 5. Widespread application. 6. Cornerstone is commitment from the top. Preamble 1. The purpose of this code is to provide international standard for the safe management and operation of ships and for pollution and prevention. Preamble 2. The Assembly adopted Resolution A.443.11, by which it invited all governments to take the necessary steps to safeguard the shipmaster in the proper discharge of his responsibilities with regard to maritime safety and the protection of the marine environment. Preamble 3. The Assembly also adopted Resolution A.680.17, by which it further recognized the need for appropriate organization of management to enable it to respond to the need of those on board ships to achieve and maintain high standards of safety and environment protection. Preamble 4. Recognizing that no two shipping companies or ship owners are the same, and that ships operate under a wide range of different conditions, the code is based on general principles and objectives. Preamble 5. The code is expressed in broad terms so that it can have a widespread application. Clearly, different levels of management, whether shore-based or at sea, will require varying levels of knowledge and awareness of the items outlined. Preamble 6. The cornerstone of good safety management is commitment from the top. In matters of safety and pollution prevention, it is the commitment, competence, attitudes and motivation of individuals at all levels that determines the end result. Part A, Implementation. 1.1. Definitions. 1.2. Objectives. 1.3. Application. 1.4. Functional requirements for a safety management system, SMS. 1.1.1. International Safety Management, ISM, Code. International Safety Management, ISM, Code means the International Management Code for the Safe Operation of Ships and the Pollution Prevention as adopted by the Assembly, as may be amended by the organization. 1.1.2. Company. Company means the owners of the ship or other organization or person such as the manager, or barefoot charter, who has assumed the responsibility for operation of the ship from the ship owner and who on assuming such responsibility has agreed to take over all the duties and responsibility imposed by the code. 1.1.3. Administration. Administration means the government of the state whose flag the ship is entitled to fly. Other new definition from 1.14-1. 1.12 can be found under Section 4 of the course material. 1.2. Objectives. 1.1.1. The objectives of the ISM code are to ensure safety at sea, prevention of human injury or loss of life, avoidance of damage to the environment, in particular, to the marine environment, and to properly. 1.2.2. Safety management objectives of the company should, inter alia. 1. Provide for safe practices in ship operation and a safe working environment. 2. Establish safeguards against all identified risks. And 3. Continuously improve safety management skills of personnel ashore and abroad ships, including preparing for emergencies related both to safety and environmental protection. 1.2.3. The safety management system should ensure. 1. Compliance with mandatory rules and regulations, and 2. that applicable codes, guides and standards recommended by the organization administrations, classification societies and maritime industry organization are taken into account. 1.3. Application. The requirements of this code may be applied to all ships. Functional requirements of a safety management system, SMS, safety and environmental policy. Instructions and procedures to ensure safe operations. Definition of responsibility and authority. Accident and non-conformance reporting. Emergency response plans. Internal audits and management reviews. 2. Safety and environmental protection policy. 2.1. The company should establish a safety and environmental protection policy which describes how the objectives, given in paragraph 1.2, will be achieved. Safety and environmental protection policy should describe how the company will provide for safe practices in ship operation. Safe working safeguards against all identified risks, continuously improve safety management skills of personnel. Emergency preparation. Responsibility for and commitment to the safety and environmental policy rests with the highest levels of management. 2. Safety and environmental protection policy. 2.2. The company should ensure that the policy is implemented and maintained at all levels of the organization, both ship-based as well as shore-based. 3. Company responsibilities and authority. 3.1. If the entity who is responsible for the operation of the ship is, other than the owner must report the full name and details of such entity to the administration. If the owner of the vessel is not the entity responsible for operational management decisions, the owner must report the details of the relationship with the operator to the administration. The organization responsible for the management of the ship should have a copy of this notification and be able to verify to an auditor the owner has complied with this requirement. 3. Company responsibilities and authority. Point 3.2. The company should define and document the responsibility and interaction of all personnel who manage, perform and verify work relating to and affecting safety and pollution prevention. An organization chart is usually used to depict the relationship of the key management personnel in the management system. A brief explanation of responsibility and authority of key personnel should be included in the management system manual. 3. Company responsibilities and authority. 3.3. The company is responsible for ensuring that adequate resources and shore-based support are provided to enable the designated person or persons to carry out their function. Resources include equipment, material, human resources, technical resources. 4. Designated person, S, to ensure the safe operation of each ship and provide a link between the company and those on boards. Every company, as appropriate, should designate a person or persons ashore having direct access to the highest level of management. The responsibility and authority of the designated person or persons should include monitoring the safety and pollution prevention aspects of the operation of each slip and to ensure that adequate resources and shore-based support are applied as required. 4. Designated person, S, point of contact for vessel ashore. May be one or more persons. Must have direct access to the highest level of management. This person serves much the same purpose as the management representative in a quality system. Must have responsibility and authority to ensure implementation and proper working of the safety management system. Potential conflict of interest should be considered by the company when designating this person. 5. Master's responsibility and authority. 5.1. The company should clearly define and document the master's responsibility with regard to, point 1, implementing the safety and environmental protection policy of the company, point 2, motivating the crew in the observation of that policy, point 3, issuing appropriate orders and instructions in a clear and simple manner, verifying that specified requirements are observed, and reviewing the SMS and reporting it deficiencies to the shore-based management. Point 4. Verifying that specified requirements are observed, and point 5. Reviewing the SMS and reporting its deficiencies to the shore-based management. 5. Master's responsibility and authority. 5.2. The company should ensure that the SMS operating on board the ship contains a clear statement emphasizing the master's authority. The company should establish in the SMS that the master has the overriding authority and the responsibility to make decision with respect to safety and pollution prevention, and to request the company's assistance as may be necessary. This statement should make it clear the master has overriding authority and responsibility to deviate from the requirements of the system in the interest of safety and pollution prevention. 6. Resources and personnel. 6.1. The company should ensure that the master is 1. Properly qualified for command, 2. Fully conversant with the company's SMS, 3. Given the necessary support so that the master's duties can be safely performed. 6. Resources and personnel. 6.2. The company should ensure that each ship is manned with qualified, certificated and medically fit seafarers in accordance with national and international requirements. 6. Resources and personnel. 6.3. The company should establish procedures to ensure that new personnel and personnel transferred to new assignments related to safety and protection of the environment are given proper familiarization with their duties. Instructions which are essential to be provided prior to sailing should be identified, documented and given. 6. Resources and personnel. 6.4. The company should ensure that all personnel involved in company's SMS have an adequate understanding of relevant rules, regulation, codes and guidelines. 6. Resources and personnel. 6.5. The company should establish and maintain procedures for identifying any training which may be required in support of the SMS and ensure that such training is provided for all personnel concerned. Training. Training requirements found in 6.2 through 6.5. Training requirements should be identified and documented. A systematic program should be developed. Consideration should be given to level of education. Previous training. Previous experience. Should ensure proficiency in the operation of the appropriate equipment. Onboard familiarization with equipment, machinery and systems should be provided. Provide training for newly installed equipment. If personnel are transferred in the fleet, ensure familiarity with new vessels' equipment. Ensure familiarity with different types of cargo being carried. Ensure personnel have adequate understanding of rules, regulations and guidelines. Ensure personnel are adequately trained in the safety management system. Records of all training should be maintained. 6. Resources and personnel. 6.6. The company should establish procedures by which the ship's personnel receive relevant information on the SMS in a working language or languages understood by them. 6. Resources and personnel. 6.7. The company should ensure that the ship's personnel are able to communicate effectively in the execution of their duties related to the SMS. 7. Development of plans for shipboard operations. The company should establish procedures for the preparation of plans and instructions, including checklists as appropriate, for key shipboard operations concerning the safety of the ship and the prevention of the pollution. The various tasks involved should be defined and assigned to qualified personnel. Operations must be conducted under controlled conditions. Documented procedures or instructions are required where their absence would adversely affect the operations. Shipboard operations categories. Navigation procedures. Deck operations. Cargo operations. Engine room operators. Safety procedures. Technical procedures. communication procedures, ship integrity procedures, pollution prevention procedures. Examples of navigation procedures: voyage planning, close quarters situations, restricted visibility, change of watch, standing orders, equipment operation. Examples of deck operations: mooring operations, anchoring, port watches, fire and security watches, arrival and departures preparation. Examples of cargo operations: pre-cargo equipment checks and inspection, watchkeeping duties, tank and hold preparation, loading, discharging and transfer operations, handling procedures for special cargoes, spill control, ballasting, gauging. Examples of engine room operations: routine watchkeeping duties, maneuvering requirements, main engine operations, auxiliary plant operations, routine inspections frequency, who performs and evaluates, who verifies that repairs have been done. Example of safety procedures: work permitting, helicopter operators, working aloft or over the side, heavy weather operations, confined space entry, handling and storage of hazardous materials, emergency briefing of supernumeraries, near misses. Examples of technical procedures: provide guidance to vessel personnel regarding rules and regulations applicable to the area of trade or cargo, ensure that surveys are conducted on schedule, provide reports on the operational capability of the plant, machinery and equipment. Examples of communication procedures: periodic reporting for the vessel, emergency and or after hours communications, emergency contacts for various scenarios, internal communications both on board and ashore. Examples of ship integrity procedures: watertight and weathertight integrity, stress and load criteria, vessel stability, draft and trim. Examples of pollution prevention procedures: bunker and oil transfer operations, special cargo handling, bilge and ballast operations, sewage and garbage disposal, engine exhaust. 8. Emergency preparedness. 8.1. The company should establish procedures to identify, describe and respond to potential emergency, shipboard, situations, emergency responses plans, salvage operations. 8. Emergency preparedness. 8.2. The company should establish programs for drills and exercises to prepare for emergency actions, drills and exercises for potential emergencies, fire and boats drills, proper use of emergency equipment, emergency generator operation, loss of steering, confined space rescue, engine room flooding. 8. Emergency preparedness. 8.3. The SMS should provide for measures ensuring that the company's organizations can respond at any time to hazards, accidents and emergency situations involving its ships, firefighting equipment inspections, vessel safety equipment inspections, oil spill response. 9. Reports and analysis of nonconformities, accidents and hazardous occurrences. 9.1. The SMS should include procedures ensuring that nonconformities, accidents and hazardous situation are reported to the company, investigated and analyzed with the objective of improving safety and pollution and prevention. The goal is to eliminate nonconformities, accidents and hazardous situations. Records of nonconformities and their disposition should be kept. A system for notification of appropriate personnel both ashore and on the vessel should be established. Control of nonconformities. The company should establish procedures to control any processes which do not conform to specified company requirements. The system should be designed to prevent inadvertent use of equipment or systems found to be unacceptable. Control of nonconformities. Control of nonconformities includes 1. Identification. 2. Documentation. 3. Evaluation. 4. Disposition. 5. Notification. Documentation. Nonconformities, accidents and hazardous situations should be documented. Accidents and hazardous situations are considered and treated as nonconformities. Hazards represent potential accidents. Evaluation of actual or potential impact or severity should be documented. Responsibility and authority for determining the disposition of a nonconformity. Disposition of nonconformities. Do not confuse this with corrective action. What is done to immediately control or minimize the effect of the nonconformity? Examples of nonconformities. Near misses. Accidents. Hazardous situations. Insurance claims. Failure of the management system to fulfill a specified requirement. Nine. Reports and analysis of nonconformities, accidents and hazardous occurrences. 9.2. The company should establish procedures for the implementation of corrective action. Corrective action. Corrective action begins with the detection of a nonconformity, accident, or hazardous situation. Circumstances relative to the nonconformities should be investigated to determine the root cause. Keep a record of the investigation. Determine the corrective action necessary to eliminate the nonconformity. Correction action should result in a documented system change to preclude reoccurrence. Implement the change. Corrective action. Corrective action taken should be 1. Appropriate to the impact may have on safety or pollution. 2. Commensurate with the risks involved. Responsibility and authority for instituting and maintaining the action system should be defined. Corrective actions should be followed up to ensure implementation and effectiveness. 10. Maintenance of the ship and equipment. 10.1. The company should establish procedures to ensure that the ship is maintained in conformity with the provisions of the relevant rules and regulations and with any additional requirements which may be established by the company. Examples of preventive maintenance. Mooring equipment, cargo system equipment, navigation equipment, main and auxiliary machinery, hull associated fittings. 10. Maintenance of the ship and equipment. 10.2. In meeting these requirements, the company should ensure that inspections are held at appropriate intervals. Any nonconformity is reported with its possible cause. If known, appropriate corrective action is taken and records of these activities are maintained. 10. Maintenance of the ship and equipment. 10.3. The company should establish procedures in SMS to identify equipment and technical systems the sudden operational failure of which may result in hazardous situations. The SMS should provide for specific measures aimed at promoting the reliability of such equipment or systems. These measures should include the regular testing for standby arrangements and equipment or technical systems that are not in continuous use. Examples of inspections and tests. Emergency equipment. medical equipment and inventory, life-saving equipment, cargo system integrity, alarms and emergency shutdowns, pre-arrival tests, fuel oil transfer system integrity, oil water separator, class surveys, regulatory inspections. 10. Maintenance of the ship and equipment. 10.4. The inspection mentioned in 10.2 as well as the measures referred to 10.3 should be integrated in the ship's operational maintenance routine. Preventive maintenance. 11. Documentation. 11.1. The company should establish and maintain procedures to control all documents and data which are relevant to the SMS. Identify all controlled documents relating to the requirements of the code or standard. Maintain master list with number, title, data and latest revision. Document methods for change control and approval. Document control. Method and degree of control should be appropriate to the type of document. 1. Safety management manual. 2. Internally produced procedures. 3. Forms. 4. Publications from external sources. 11. Documentation. 11.2. The company should ensure that, 1. Valid documents are available at all relevant locations. 2. Changes to documents are reviewed and approved by authorized personnel. And, 3. Obsolete documents are promptly removed. Example of documents to control. Safety Management Manual, SMM, Procedures, Work Instructions, Dated Material, Charts, Lights List, Emergency Response Plan. Documentation. 11.3. The documents used to describe and implement the SMS may be referred to as the Safety Management Manual. Documentation should be kept in a form that the company considers most effective. Each ship should carry on board all documentation relevant to the ship. 12. Company verification, review and evaluation. 12.1. The company should carry out internal safety audits to verify whether safety and pollution prevention activities comply with the SMS. Scope and frequency depend on the criticality. 12. Company verification, review and evaluation. 12.2. The company should periodically evaluate the efficiency and when needed review the SMS in accordance with procedures established by the company. Management reviews. Audit results should be made part of the annual management review of the system. 12. Company verification, review and evaluation. 12.3. The audits and possible corrective actions should be carried out in accordance with documented procedures. 12. Company verification, review and evaluation. 12.4. Personnel carrying out audits should be independent of the areas being audited unless this is impracticable due to the size and nature of the company. 12. Company verification, review and evaluation. 12.5. The results of the audits and reviews should be brought to the attention of all personnel having responsibility in the area involved. 12.6. The management personnel responsible for the area involved should take timely corrective action on deficiencies found. Internal audits. A company should consider the following procedures: planning and scheduling, performance, reporting, follow-up, records. Internal audits should occur at least annually. A corrective action plan and target closure date should be established. Follow-up for effectiveness of corrective actions required. Audits should be documented. Checklists are encouraged. Follow-up should be documented. Part B. Certification and verification. 13. Certification and periodic verification. 13.1, the ships should be operated by a company which is issued a document of compliance or with an interim document of compliance in accordance with paragraph 14.1, relative to that ship. 13.2. A document of compliance should be issued by the administration or, at the request of the administration, by another contracting government to the convention to any company complying with the requirements of this code for a period specified by the administration which should not exceed 5 years. Such a document should be accepted as evidence that the company is capable of complying with the requirements of this code. 13.3. The document of compliance is only valid for the ship types explicitly indicated in the documents. Such indication should be based on the types of ships on which the initial verification was based. Other ship types should be added after verification of the company's capability to comply with the requirements of this code applicable such ships types. In this context, ship types are those referred to in Regulation 9/1 of the Convention. 13.4. The validity of the document of compliance should be subject to annual verification by the administration or an organization recognized by the administration or, at the request of the administration by another contracting government within 3 months before or after the anniversary date. 13. Certification and periodic verification. 13.5. The document of compliance should be withdrawn by the administration or by an organization recognized by the administration or, at the request of the administration by another contracting government which issued the document, when the annual verification required in paragraph 13.4 is not requested or if there is evidence of major non-conformities with this code. 13.5.1. All associated safety management certificates and/or interim safety management certificates should also be withdrawn if the document of compliance is withdrawn. 13.6. A copy of the document of compliance should be placed on board in order that the master of the ship, if so requested, may produce it for verification of the administration or by an organization recognized by the administration or for the purposes of control referred to in Regulation 9/6.2 of the Convention. The copy of the document is not required to be authenticated or certified. 13.7. The safety management certificate should be issued to a ship for a period which should not exceed 5 years by the administration or an organization recognized by the administration or, at the request of the administration by another contracting government. The safety management certificate should be issued after verifying that the company and its shipboard management operate in accordance with the approved safety management system. Such certificate should be accepted as evidence that the ship is complying with the requirements of this code. When issuing the certificate, verify that the company and its shipboard management operate in accordance with the approved SMS. 13. Certification and periodic verification. 13.8. The validity of the safety management certificate should be subject to at least one intermediate verification by the administration or, at the request of the administration by another contracting government. If only one intermediate verification is to be carried out and the period of validity of the safety management certificate is 5 years, it should take place between the second and third anniversary date of the safety management certificate. 13.9. In addition to the requirements of paragraph 13.5.1, the safety management certificate should be withdrawn by the administration or, at the request of the administration by another contracting government which has issued it when the intermediate verification required by paragraph 13.8.8. is not requested or if there is evidence of major non-conformity with this code. 13.10. Notwithstanding the requirements of paragraph 13.2 and 13.7, when the renewal verification is completed within 3 months before the expiry date of the existing document of compliance or safety management certificate, the new document of compliance or the new safety management certificate should be valid from the date of completion of the renewal verification for a period not exceeding 5 years from the date of expiry of the existing document of compliance or safety management certificate. 13.11. when the renewal verification is completed, within 3 months before the expiry date of the existing document of compliance or safety management certificate, the new document of compliance or the new safety management certificate should be valid from the date of completion of the renewal verification for a period not exceeding 5 years from the date of completion of the renewal verification. 14. Interim Certification 14.1. An interim document of compliance may be issued to facilitate initial implementation of this code when, 1. Company is newly established, or 2. New ship types are to be added to an existing document of compliance, following verification that the company has a safety management system that meets the objectives of paragraph 1.2.3 of this code, provided the company demonstrates plans to implement a safety management system meeting the full requirements of this code within the period of validity of the interim document of compliance, should be issued for a period not exceeding 12 months by the administration or an organization recognized by the administration, or at the request of the administration by another contracting government. A copy of the interim document of compliance should be placed on board in order that the master of the ship, if so requested, may produce it for verification of the administration or by an organization recognized by the administration or for the purposes of control, referred to in Regulation 9/6.2 of the Convention. The copy of the document is not required to be authenticated or certified. 14.2. An interim safety management certificate may be issued, 1. To new ships on delivery, 2. When a company takes on responsibility for operation of a ship which is new to the company, or 3. When a ship changes flag, such an interim safety management certificate should be issued for a period not exceeding 6 months by the administration or an organization recognized by the administration by another contracting government. 14.3. An administration or, at the request of the administration, another contracting government may, in special cases, extend the validity of an interim safety management certificate for a further period which should not exceed 6 months from date of expiry. 14.4. An interim safety management certificate may be issued following verification that, 1. The document of compliance, or the interim document of compliance, is relevant to the ship concerned, 2. The safety management system provided by the company for the ship concerned includes elements of this code and has been assessed during the audit for issuance of the document of compliance, or demonstrated for issuance of the interim document of compliance. 3. The company has planned the audit of the ship within 3 months. 4. The master and officers are familiar with the safety management system and the planned arrangements for its implementation. 5. Instructions, which have been identified as being essential, are provided prior to sailing, and 6. Relevant information on the safety management system has been given in a working language or languages understood by the ship's personnel. 15. Verification. 15.1. All verification required by the provision of this code should be carried out in accordance with procedures acceptable to the administration, taking into account the guidelines developed by the organization. Refer to the Guidelines on Implementation of the International Safety Management, ISM, Code by Administration, adopted by the organization by Resolution A.7888-19-16, Forms of Certificates. 16.1. The Document of Compliance, the Safety Management Certificate, the Interim Document of Compliance and the Interim Safety Management Certificate should be drawn up in a form corresponding to the models given in the appendix to this code. If the language used is neither English nor French, the text should include a translation into one of these languages. 16.2. In addition to the requirements of paragraph 13.3, the ship types indicated on the document of compliance and the interim document of compliance may be endorsed to reflect any limitations in the operations of the ships described in the safety management system.